Up a few things that have passed in the different sessions today. This was supposed to be a fourth member of the panel as well, but he got lost, whatever that means in Rotterdam. Okay, so we have three contributors to the panel discussion. And, well, we just try to open up to the audience as well. So we're going to forth and back to the panel. But I want just to open up, just to give the three members the opportunity just to phrase or to define what this problematic term of speculative for them means. So we're talking about speculative approaches to art history. But what does it mean, speculative? So please, in a very short statement, how do you define that speculative, Elizabeth?
I think speculative art, I start immediately with the art, is what art is in general. And I think that problems that we face all the time in conceptualization in philosophy is have become so enormous that we are somehow forced to come back on what the art practice has already in a certain way, in a paradigmatical way, lived for times on. It means that if there's a break in philosophical conceptualization as it is, as we face it now in front of the possibility or impossibility of an ontology of in front of reality, in front of being, or in front of ecology, or whatever. I mean, there's so many problems right now. Then, if we want to go further on, we have to look for a sort of new complicity. And I think that the productivity, I mean, the way that art goes ahead, the way that art processes it's itself. I mean, by developing its rules and following it, it's of course it's a sort of game, it's a sort of reality game, it's a sort of conceptual game, but it's not marked by the problem we face in philosophy that it's a sort of solipsistic stuff you're stuck in, because you can say, oh, okay, you it's your invention, or like we saw it now in Risa Nigaristani's talk. Who came back to a sort of radical solipsism or dualism, or I mean, it's the total non-possibility of any ontology, I would say. Okay. It ends up with the catastrophe of simulation, as you said, as alienation. So any concept that likes to grasp the world or anything is a cheap inventionist stuff. And I think that art just had another sort of procedure that was lived. And so it's not for nothing that all the time philosophy tries to recreate itself. It comes back to art and tries to just cope with some of the procedures that are...
Okay, Bertrand, you came in later, but we want to ask you just to give a short comment on the...
I don't know, I think it's too close.
Yeah, on the category of speculative, what does it mean? So, and especially not only to art, but to art history. So speculative theories towards approaches to art history. What does that, is that something real? Or are we connecting things that can't be combined? You can take that phone.
I would say that there are several ways of practicing a speculative thing thought on in art history. If we intend to think the work of art as an object for philosophy, for metaphysics, for speculation, it is not interesting, because it does not change in any sense our concept or way of feeling, but a speculative way for history of art can, I think, must always start from the artwork themselves.
Sure.
And it means that, of course, and I'm the first one to, I practice things like that. We can, but we must relate works of art with philosophies, with philosophers, but in a way of speaking like and against Descartes, not as a métaphysique première, philosophie première, mais as a philosophie seconde, une métaphysique seconde, where we always start from the singularity, and then after we can see how the concepts can change.
Okay. Let's try it again. So there are a lot of approaches to art history, and one of these approaches is speculative. So what I want to know is why speculative, and what does it how is it discerned between other approaches to art history? What makes speculative specific?
Well, I mean, you just asked me, before we prepared, you told me what you're going to ask, so I wrote down points. So the first point for me, I'm partly going to repeat what I said yesterday, is a temporal element. If you want to understand what's going on now in our present, it's not just there. We're not working on a material that's visible for us, but we have to construct it. So it's necessary, this kind of speculative constructivism, to use like Stenger's term, is necessary in a way also to understand the asynchrony we are dealing with. We heard today about the Gothic digital also, you know, like, I mean, that's obviously... So our present is like a present that can only be understood as a contemporary, let me in the sense of different temporalities within our present. So that would, I would say that's the first thing, the temporality. Linked with that is the second question, or like the speculative element, how can we think the real in a way that it's not yet preconditioned by thought? I think that's a genuine, that's a question that's genuinely interesting for art since always, you know, like to understand artworks that have not been like thought before, that are not just like picturing, representing thoughts that have already been thought. So that, I would say, that's the second thing, and both, I think, relate in a way to what Hegel called the speculative. Or today we talked a bit, or Reza mentioned it as well, this moment of abduction. So we think about artworks, or me myself, if I work on literature, I don't want to deduce it from something I know already, or just induce something, but if I need to invent something, I got to produce something new. And that's what Hegel very nicely described as the movement of the speculative movement of thought, in a way, where the subject like disappears in whatever he's dealing with. So that the predicate defines the subject, and the subject in a way disappears. So, and I think that's very concrete. You mentioned it as well, that we can not just learn something maybe from artworks, but we have to adopt our methodology. Or if you really have an encounter with artworks or with art, then there's a transformation that means a transformation on an ontological level of the artworks themselves, of our methodologies, and also of ourselves. And just one thing that I tried to stress before, or bring up before in our discussion, is something I call like literature at large. That means like I try to not work anymore on particular novels and what they really want to say, or their authors, you know, what might their aesthetics be or their belief system, but really think about language and how language as materiality changes over history.
Okay, we can come back later to this. I think kind of modernist approach, because the Mallarmé already defined it as a subjectivity, the literature and the écriture. But let so
I would disagree, but
we can go enhance that later on. Okay, so even just a short definition.
Okay, well, as a preliminary note, I should probably say that I'll have to be leaving early, probably because we're running behind schedule.
Oh, it's good when you start saying that you have to leave. Yeah,
no, I'm not going to run out because I'm angry or whatever. Right. As far as the speculative is concerned, I guess I'll just say a few things. First of all, what I've heard today, I haven't really heard a concise or clear definition of what the speculative might be. I've heard a lot of philosophy, and I was struck by what Schurz said at the beginning of his lecture. He said, I'll be doing a speculative reading or a speculative approach to art history or mannerism in art, but you might also want to call it Deleuzian, which would be the implication being that Deleuzianism would somehow be speculative. I don't think that's the case, and I don't think we really have a definition of the speculative within art history. And I would like to submit the idea that the speculative in itself, as a concept, has a very difficult or problematic relation with art history, or at least with the concept of historicity. As soon as you enter into the historicity of things, as soon as you are interested in doing something historically or taking a historical approach, it's definitely true that you're interested in doing something that would somehow confirm or affirm the singularity of historicity or the contingency of a certain singular event within history. But that in itself doesn't leave a lot of room for a more mythological definition of the speculative, I think. When you do try to do that, I do think, and I do agree with Heng, that you seem to move towards a very modernist approach of what art would be, namely inventing the new, creating the new within history. So from the contingent moment of history, creating something new out of that. I can see that Bernard is not willing to call that modernist, and probably you're not as well, but I do think that we're still very premised or biased on this concept of the new as a very modernist concept. So I'm a little afraid that anything that we're just trying to define as speculative could be a move back to modernism, which
okay.
I would be critical
of. We have
of.
A debate, I think.
Do you want to react? Or
I would say that the question for me, but I guess for everybody of us, is always the same. It's not a question of what is speculative. I think we don't need this word. It's just a question of thought. What does it mean to think, not from concept, but from the work from a work of art? Mm-hmm. It's not absolutely simple, because it's very difficult.
But what makes the thought of a singularity or a singular work speculative? When does the thought of this singular work become speculative? When? What happens in between?
I apologize for my English. When you can think that a concept or an idea it's not a question of representation, but that when you arrive to the idea that an idea or concept can be something aesthetic, can be a work of art, not a concept of work of art, mm-hmm. not an idea of art, not an, a concept or notion of a work of art, but this work of art.
Okay, but we agree on that, I think, all the five of us.
Yes,
agree
we agree, almost nobody do that. We agree, but almost nobody do that. We speak about art, saying we speak empirically of art, but generally we don't speak about this work of art, this singularity. It's easier to articulate speculative thought and a concept of art or a period of art. But a period of art, there is nothing singular in a period of art.
Just to get a grip on it, who is we?
The mainstream the discourse of art, even in its more interesting aspect.
All right. Okay.
Yeah, I would distinguish between two notions of speculative. I mean, speculation as a notion has always been used in philosophy. It's nothing new. It was always there. It's there since the Middle Ages, I would say. And as I understood it now, it's to be taken in a very technical way now, because it's linked to the movement of speculative thinkers now, the new philosophy. And as far as I understood, they want to escape from correlationalism. They want to get out of, yeah, exactly. We talk about the speculative turn. And then I would say, okay, this is not about looking at art now as one of between a range of possible objects. I think there's a sort of convergency, is it the right word? Convergence between philosophy and art. And I cannot imagine that we now look at art objects in a new way and rediscover art objects. I think there's a strong movement of aesthetization going on in philosophy since 200 years. It's a very, very strong movement, and it has become even stronger the last 30 years. I think there's nothing left than aesthetics, more or less, in philosophy.
So you're concluding that the speculative term doesn't add any new elements to the way we are talking about art the last 200 years?
No, this is not what I want to say. I want to say there's a convergence between speculative philosophy, contemporary speculative philosophy, and art. And why is this a convergence? It has a certain history already, but I think that what both aim at as a philosophy and art, and this is why they are somehow entering the same field of force now, is that they want to deliver what is the term being or what is reality from this negative and broken conceptualization we have faced since the last I don't know how many decennies. Yeah.
My more or less critical remark that what you are formulating is a modernist way of approaching art in literature, for instance, which is not a problem. But
I mean, the modernism deals with like always producing something new. You know, like I tried to say that yesterday, and something like avant-garde is interested in the tomorrow or so or in the future, whereas like what I'm interested in is the contemporary. So it's exactly not the new, but. Maybe, you know, you made another critical remark or you were asking rhetorically, like, is this speculative, whatever, and bring something new in thinking about art? But I would rather say, like, whose claim is that? You know, it's not the claim of the speculative philosophers. You know, they exactly make the contrary point by the way they work, the way they not write about art, deliberately, maybe a bit Graham Harman recently, but... So it's a claim against the kind of exhausted post-structuralist decades, you know, who was like very interdisciplinary and don't want to argue against that, but in a way it is exhausted. And what we have to take that serious as a symptom in itself, you know. On the one hand, the exhaustion and the kind of desire to adopt a new theory that really deals with the real, you know, that this theory in itself doesn't want to deal with art, or maybe that hasn't got anything to say to art, might be yet another problem. But like, there might be many misunderstandings. But like, again, I want to say, I really want to bring this up, this provocative, maybe provocative thought in relation to what I just said about these speculative realists not wanting to deal with artists. Maybe there are also like ontological transformations going on within the field of art, that art has lost its kind of ontological primacy of producing images, producing objects. I mean, Google does that, everyone does that. There's a kind of overabundance of image production that art is no longer, maybe, as David Chozolet calls it, we're we enter the phase of after art, you know? So
that art is everywhere.
Or
at least a decision.
Or this concept of art is no longer relevant. I mean, that's a bit why I'm asking, like, what is it really still about, like, individual artworks or artists? Maybe we can do that another 150 years, but, like, history will prove, you know, that it's no longer the point. You know, something has changed, and not just like we're no longer minimalist or modern or postmodern, but really like on this ontological level, like what is the function of art? Maybe we have to think differently about art. Maybe in a few years we'll see that that was the point about the speculative realist or initial like misunderstandings. I don't know. I don't have the answer. But
it's the fact that daily life and all our occupations with different domains of life has been aestheticized Is that one of the reasons that art shifted to different domains? Or
when you say aestheticized, I mean there are two ways of understanding it. One is the kind of negative, or like the Jameson would criticize the postmodernity as a kind of as if there was something real that then afterwards becomes like embellished or like made beautiful.
That's
or
what
so.
I mean.
But then you would say that there is no real in the first place, and everything is already structured by language or and so on. So that this would be a kind of post-structuralist understanding. Christoph Menke recently wrote a book exactly about that, trying to defend or make another point about aestheticization, aestheticierung, exactly in this positive sense. But I think
what would be the positive sense? You've articulated clearly enough the negative sense, in which the aesthetics is something that is not real, and that, or at least something that brings us into a world where aesthetics is all around us, and aesthetics is really the only thing we've got left. And you mentioned Jameson, but what would be the positive sense of aesthetics then?
Positive, not in the sense of oh that's good, but positive in the sense of like I posit something, like something is like actually. Like since the invention of aesthetics, or since the late 18th century, we live in what Rancière called an aesthetic regime, and that means
Rancière claims that we're living in an aesthetic regime. I haven't seen the regime myself. I mean, what is the positive about it?
A positive, just like in
do
a,
you
in
mean
a way
it's productive?
Productive in the sense of ideology. You can understand in Althusserian sense the way. I can only repeat myself. I don't have that many thoughts. What I said yesterday. I mean, the regime is like the university we live in, the kind of professions we have, and how we communicate with each other, what kind of dissertations we write. You know, these are all inventions of the late 18th century, at a time when philosophy entronized itself as the kind of the top of the pyramid of all these disciplines, the way we deal with theory, the important theory has for art, and so on. I mean, this is like, for me, these are parts of this ideology, but not in the kind of negative sense, but of this regime. Yeah?
Okay, so let's go back to the initial question. So, and the items and the topics that were addressed today. So one of the main topics that was addressed was art history. So we are now talking about artworks. You know, that's something you're talking about, an artwork, singularity that in one way or the other has to be, has the primacy in order to at least evoke something. But now there is this secondary domain of art history. So, and the original title is Speculative Approaches to Art Histories. That's the title of the topic of today. So what does that mean? So we are all agree that when we talk about art, we have to talk about art practices and the primary process of art practices. That's okay. But now there is the question whether we can approach those art practices without art history, for instance. What does that mean? And once you want to approach them without art historical categories, for instance, what does speculation mean in that sense? Is philosophy taking over from art history, for instance? Do we need a conceptuality to make it even broader? Do we need to think? I can't make it any broader, you know. Do we stop thinking when looking at a piece of art or when making a piece of art? Because that's a suggestion. I don't think you can make a piece of art without thinking. It's incredible. There's always thought.
The question has so many aspects. The main aspect is when you say speculative, and when you say history of art, there's a clash, because
so.
From centuries, history of art is we said that history of art was born in the Renaissance, but it's false. It's not the discipline history of art, but. If you even pronounce the term of speculation in the department at the University of the History of Art, you're shot. It's finished. Oh. So why? Yes. I know. Je sais. Bon. What do we do with this resistance? Can I say this resistance of speculative body of metaphysics or philosophy or concept to the thing of art, work of art, idea of art, practice of art, whatever you want, something with art. Yeah, there is something. Voilà. At the end, what is the problem? It's easy to say, but it's so difficult to do something with that. Is a work of art is something which is intelligible and sensible, and we from
is
the
so? Is that so?
It's
is
both
a work of art. In you can't get into the work of art with thought, or it's alien to the work of art. That's what you suggest.
I mean that a work of art is it's prior to the distinction between sensible and intelligible. Or all the tradition from the Greeks said there is the intelligible and sensible. So we cannot for centuries, for millenaries, for centuries, we have so much difficulty to think what is a plastic idea, an aesthetic idea. Which would not be a produce of a representation of the intelligible. No, maybe it's I'm not clear. But
no,
it's
I understand what you're saying.
It's too simple. It's said like that. Of course, it's too simple. It's very c'est grossier. But actually, the first condition is to recognize the capacity to an image to think.
Yeah.
But what does it mean for an image to think?
Yes, right. That was the question. Yeah.
It's the first question. It's so difficult to answer this question. But this might be the only one question.
Okay. Perhaps someone in the audience can help us.
Can I just say, I mean, that there was nearly a description of I don't want to talk too much about Rancière, but like the way he defines aesthetic regime, because you asked me, was like it's a thinking, you know, that it has become like alienated from itself, you know, and it always has a problematic relationship with the sensory, and as a sensory that is also alienated to itself, and it needs the intellectual, it needs the conceptual, and if we think about like the art, at least in the last 100 years, that's a marvelous example for exactly that. And if there is something, at least a claim from these speculative philosophers, is like, no, we are able to think the absolute. We can think it. It's a response, you know, or it's a counterclaim. That's it. I mean, that's if it's not more, then it's not more. But at least it's a claim, and I think the desire for it. Might be a misunderstanding, might be misleading so far, might be I don't know what, but like there's a basic understanding. So
okay.
I thought that was interesting.
Okay. Are there any questions in the audience? Just to enhance this exploration or to clear, elucidate something? Yeah.
Coming back to your question, Hank, of what is speculative in an artwork and what is speculative in art history, I'm not very convinced about this question at all, because it puts too much the both things at two different sides. So it's a dualism between an artwork, which is closed in itself, which has a substance, which is an object, and at the other side, an investigator who comes and does something with this object. So I think it would be wrong to see the possibilities of speculative art histories or speculative realism in claiming that the artwork is an object like this or has its own world. I think in reality it's much more intertwined, the relationship. So an artwork is of course a materiality and has its own reality, and this we can learn I think from speculative realism maybe. And speculative would be to say, okay, we understand that there's something we cannot grasp totally. But at the same time, the reality of an artwork is as well the speculative investigation of art historian, of a reception of everybody, so which constructs as well as a part of the reality of this object, and which means that an art object is never closed like this, but is always open and reconstructed in every moment in each context.
Okay, but doesn't that mean, that's also a question that I put on the table, that once you are into a speculation on art or art theory or art history, the element of speculation is totality. It's not just thinking about something. You're going? Okay. Or you're fed up. Yeah. So abrupt, okay. So is the speculation, because you mentioned Hegel, when Hegel speaks about a speculative Satz, with a speculative proposition, there is something that is contradicted. So a being is nothing. That's a speculative Satz. Yeah? So there is something in Hegel, that's why he calls it speculative, because at every instance of the particularity, there is a scope towards the totality. That's the speculative aspect of thought, that once you have something which is singular, the work of art, as a work of art, it is categorized or conceptualized within a broader scope, as a result of which it becomes part of a bigger totality. That is the instance of speculation.
But that's,
and that's not what I heard in all the discussions.
But that's a teleological reading of the sentence. I read it really as a theory of like reading and writing, because what Hegel really marvelously describes is like you read the sentences and everyone knows that and you just don't understand them. And you read now, you read Hegel and you read it and it doesn't make sense. And for him, the point is like also the reader as a subject, that there's a contradiction between me thinking in a normal, rational way and not yet speculative. And he describes this transformation of a reader who becomes a philosopher, which is in his case for him, of course, a speculative philosopher, whom you only become that not just by reading, but by writing. But you know, you have to become this. So that means it's not just being and nothing, but it's like me, the rational me, becoming a speculative philosopher. And I mean, there is something to learn about, also methodologically, about how we relate to whatever we do, whether we are art historians or. But like we would really have to think like what kind of real are we talking here? It's not a Lacanian chaotic real. It's not a kind of representative real. But what real is that is claimed that science can tell us something about? You know, so it's a very different real as well as a many different
understandings
of history. You know?
But then again, the word speculation refers to a totality, and the speculative term, well, I don't know whether I understood what I read, but what I understood is that they try to make a fiction theory that covers the totality. So when we are talking about art, and when there is an option that there is a speculative aspect to art history or art producing, then there must be a bigger story in which art is fitted, which can't be a modern story for that matter. Not even a pre-modern story, and never a postmodern story. But what is the totality in which art plays a different role that is different from all the other totalities? And that's the speculative argument, I think.
You're right, but the problem, I guess, is also history, because
it's no longer history. That's the issue. That was the issue this morning.
It's not history, that is a totality. I mean that the murder, the death, or even the murderer of speculative thought, speculative philosophy, and metaphysics, with the philosophy you know, Kant, by instance. For instance.
Well, we try to let's say Leibniz,
bon.
Or let's say. Wolf.
Bon, but no, but. So this the possibility to make ontology to question the totality. Voilà. This way of practicing philosophy has something to do with the traditional concept we have of the work of what is a work of art. So of course, when at the beginning of the 21st century, when you say let us articulate speculative thought and work of art, there is something which gives the impression that it cannot work. Bon. So the first question is what kind of speculative thought do we want to practice? Because speculative, so many.
Thinkers within the speculative term do propose a way of thinking.
But of course, the automatically consequence of this question is, of course, our concept of work of art won't be able to be the same, because we, as it has been already said, our concept of work of art means an object, something, a thing. A work of art for us is a thing. It's a material thing. It's an object, and we are subject. But if the way you practice your speculative philosophy means that you don't want any you don't want the relationship between subject and object, of course your concept of work of art changes completely.
So it's not correlistic any longer. So what does it mean if we take the critique on correlism serious?
Oui,
and adapt it to art. What does that mean?
I mean that there is a particular relationship between metaphysics, between speculative thought, and history of the theory of art. I mean the. Je l'ai déjà dit. Enfin, je
vais
pas m'embêter. Parce que je apologize, but. I can read English, but for me it's.
But you can phrase it in French.
I can speak a little French if I speak slowly. Oh, parce que sinon it's a torture. It's a torturing. Il y a une connivence, une articulation sous-jacente de l'histoire de la métaphysique et de l'histoire de la théorie de l'art depuis les Grecs, mais surtout depuis la Renaissance italienne. C'est-à-dire que si on prend un cas particulier, un trait de cette métaphysique, le rapport sujet-objet. Il est manifeste la fondation moderne de la subjectivité, ou la fondation de la subjectivité moderne, depuis Descartes, voilà, depuis Descartes, Kant. Voilà. Mais on a exactement la même chose dans le domaine de l'art. Qu'est-ce qu'invente la Renaissance italienne? Pas dans les tableaux, pas dans les œuvres d'art, mais dans la pensée de l'art, ce qui n'est pas du tout la même chose. Dans la théorie de l'art, c'est aussi une fondation de la subjectivité. Donc les deux s'appuient. La mise à mort, le meurtre de la métaphysique comme discours sur la totalité, sur discours sur le tout, c'est-à-dire la mise en crise, voire l'assassinat d'une philosophie de la nature, moi je dirais plutôt ça, c'est plus mon option philosophique, moins la pensée spéculative que une philosophie de la nature, qui a été assassinée par Kant. Il y a une impossibilité de faire une philosophie de la nature. Qui fait la philosophie de la nature? C'est la science et plus la philosophie. Eh bien ça, c'était le geste a été accompagné ou a été préparé ou a été devancé par la théorie de l'art.
Okay, but c'est la, we agree on the fact that we agree. I'll speak English.
Yeah, yes, of course.
Then we agree on the fact that speculation ends in modern times after Kant.
We agree.
So we agree. So the suggestion is that once we start again talking about speculation, we have to deal with that moment, with that very moment. And exactly what all those thinkers within the speculative term do is overdetermine that speculation with modern means, neurology, biology, all kind of sciences that are on a scientific level accepted as modern sciences. But they speculate, and that's the moment of speculation, because they are trying to overrule human understanding in finding objectivity somewhere before men, or in a cosmological order, or in dissipation in a complete cosmological order. So what has art to do with this broad scope? That's when I asked Reza, I asked him, what does this mean for art? What does it mean for creativity? He said, there's no creativity. Of course, there can't be any creativity because the subject is gone.
Maybe,
what kind of art you're talking about. You're talking about an aesthetic art. You talk about a modern art or
that question was, of course.
You talk about artworks and subjects that define.
Is there another? In correlation, give me another other concept of art.
I'm not an artist, but I'm very suspicious that we can continue doing like. You can also write sonatas or whatever or quartets like in the Mozart style, but maybe a certain paradigm has ended, which doesn't mean that we don't continue.
No, of course we make the things we always made. No problem.
Puts money into it that we continue doing a certain kind of art. We don't know it yet, you know. But like there's a disagreement.
Yeah, but that's
interesting.
That's interesting. We don't know it yet. We don't know it yet. But that's exactly the reason why speculation is needed.
Je veux dire,
not science, yeah, but speculation.
On pose cette question. We ask all these questions from art, and it's not by chance. It's not by chance.
No.
Que ces questions de réinstauration de la métaphysique, de la pensée spéculative, ça se fait depuis l'art, et ça pourrait se faire depuis l'anthropologie, depuis la science politique, depuis la biologie, depuis plein d'autres champs. Mais comme par hasard, ça se fait depuis l'art. Et ça, à mon avis, c'est profondément lié au fait qu'il y a une résistance, à l'heure actuelle encore, du champ artistique, du domaine artistique, je parle pour le concept, enfin de la chose artistique, à toutes les tentatives minoritaires de pratiques de philosophie de la nature au 19e siècle et encore au 20e siècle. Voilà. On a beau vouloir réinstaurer, on a beau critiquer la relation sujet-objet, on a beau critiquer l'anthropocentrisme, on a beau critiquer le monde de la représentation, on a beau critiquer tout ça, mais ça résiste, on a beau critiquer le substantialisme, où est-ce que ça résiste le plus, tout ça? Dans l'œuvre d'art.
Voilà.
But in art, it's still alive. It's still alive. Why does it? It's very symptomatic.
This goes too quickly. So we can still say that art is still alive. Well, Arturo is still alive.
Oui, mais c'est pas ce que je dis. It's not what I say.
Art is still alive. Because we observe daily life still with the same categories, we think we see art. We see Damien Hirst, and he makes beautiful things, but art is gone because he already has sold it before he had made it. There's no critique, there's no experience of art any longer, but we say it's art, because we really are into those categories all along the way, but perhaps something else is happening, and we can't see what is happening. So perhaps we need this speculation in order to see what is happening at the same time.
Yes, but this question of the end of art, if there is some... if somebody does not believe in art, peccato per lui. Tant pis pour eux. Enfin voilà. Enfin ceux qui croient plus en l'art, voilà. Tant pis. Tant pis pour vous. Nous on y croit. Moi j'y crois. Il y en a qui croient. On est nombreux à y croire. Voilà. Tant pis pour eux quoi. C'est donc c'est pas donc
that's
le problème.
The meaning of the end of art is only that the categories that we use to understand the position and the role of art are no longer adequate to position it, and that's why we need a new discourse on art. And that's a question that was raised. Well, I think
it's not just a discourse on art. You know, that would be as it would change.
Okay.
Art. I mean, art changes as well. You know.
Oui,
I
mean,
I want also to make a little remark, because you mentioned the strong relation between art and metaphysics in Renaissance. So I think that it is really the crucial point also for modernity. I have a long-term conception of modernity. I'm so very sorry, but 400 years are nothing in this respect. So, in Renaissance, I can see, after the invention of infinity, there's a big turn in ontology and a big turn in philosophy, mention Giordano Bruno, and Giordano Bruno tries to transform philosophy itself into art. So philosophy itself becomes an art. He calls it or a technique. It's an art, and it's a technique. It's an art of conceptualizing, of modifying. It's an art. Because
but then you broaden the definition of art and apply it on a meta level, and then
no,
you
it's
say
it's a symptom of crisis. It's a symptom of crisis that has several reasons. the one of it is infinity, the second is immanentism that follows from it, which means that I don't have any more these topological moments of knowledge. I cannot only like have knowledge of nature, knowledge of mathematics. It's all intertwined. It's irrelevant where I start, and I do not have any more the possibility to conceive of objectivity of something completely separated from the field of cognition.
Yep.
It's impossible. And this really turns the things around. Okay. And I think this is a very progressive model we could somehow link up with.
Okay, well, there's the constraint of time, and we it's the best to end the debate when people get frustrated because they can't say anything any longer. So let's end this debate. Thank you very much.